philandering partners a thing or two. Her solo album was eagerly awaited, so it became no surprise when the first single, Another Sad Love Song, went to number one. But what was to follow, no one suspected. Now some 4 million albums later, Braxton is hoping her latest single, How Many Ways, becomes her fourth number one hit. She had a dream year, countless awards, comparisons to contemporary greats Anita Baker and Whitney Houston, and a successful concert tour. All this from a woman who as a youngster couldn't listen to secular music or watch Soul Train because of her strict religious upbringing, although she now confesses to sneaking a listen and a peek when her folks left the house. I caught up with the singer in Los Angeles and wondered if it was strange to see where she's ended up, considering her background.
It's not really strange because this is something I've dreamt of doing all my life. It took me 10 years to get here overnight. And I've always wanted this, so it's always been a very important part of the puzzle of my life. And I'm so fortunate, feel so blessed to be here. I've had a tremendous year. Truly been blessed.
Your story, anybody who's read it, really reads like a PR person's dream. I mean, you know, what you went through as a child in terms of what you finally became is just totally opposite. The family was very religious, that you didn't watch television, secular music was a definite no-no, your dad was a minister, and that you had to sneak, as many kids did, particularly growing up in very religious homes, secular music and television, etc., mm-hmm. etc. Did you feel at all at that point sheltered?
Not then, because I didn't know. It's all I knew. I was 7 years old when we got into that religion, apostolic, tomato, I'm not sure. I could watch television. I just couldn't listen, watch things like Soul Train, anything that played secular music I couldn't participate in. And I didn't feel any different because I was 7 years old, we got into that religion, and we didn't leave 12. So during my developmental years, I just thought that was just the way of life for me.
Mm-hmm. When you look at how things have changed for you, do you think that that has helped you now?
Yes.
In terms of the person you are now?
I think so. I think because I couldn't listen to secular music was taboo, I had to have it. I had to listen to it. I yearned for it. My parents would leave, go grocery shopping, and I'd sneak, turn on the radio, sneak, turn on the television, anything. So. It became a passion to do it. Although I love gospel music, don't misunderstand me, just to sing secular, I think that aided in me, you know, becoming a secular singer.
I read somewhere where on one of the occasions that you snuck and cut the radio on, you heard a few bars of Do You Know the Way to San Jose? And you just sang it over and over?
Over and over. I didn't know the words because I only got one part of the song. And then on television, I have the greatest hits of Dionne Warwick, and it was like great hits like Do You Know the Way to San Jose? And all those kind of songs. So I just, well, that's all enough. So this, I know a little more now, but for years I knew that one little part, so I'd change it and make my own lyrics sometimes and things like that.
Do you remember the lyric you made up?
Oh, gosh. I remember this little boy, he was older than. I had a crush on at church, and I'd say, I know a guy named, I'd say, Ed Gordon, he's handsome. I just change the lyrics, whatever, it's a little kid thing, so.
Excellent lyric there, young lady. Excellent. One of the things I found interesting, and I want to get into the tie that you and Anita Baker seem to have as you go through life, but one of the things that I heard from Anita when we had a chance to sit down and talk is people kept talking about how deep her voice was, and people told her early on, you can't sing. It doesn't sound right. That was what you heard early on, isn't it?
Yeah. So I was told I couldn't sing. Oh, gosh, it's too masculine. She sounds like Barry White. And then once Anita Baker came out, they said, okay, she sounds like Anita Baker, but she's an Anita Baker wannabe. So, of course, that was up. So it took some time before people, I should say, learned to like my voice or just liked it for whatever reason.
You also had another tie to Anita in the sense that two of your biggest hits, the two songs on Boomerang, were originally penned for Anita Baker.
Yes.
She was pregnant during the time. You took those songs. Did you find that ironic that you followed her and, you know, the middle of yours and here you
are? Yes, yes, yes. When we originally did Give You My Heart, they said, this is for Anita Baker and Faith. I was like, okay, Tony, we need you to do a demo. Okay, then it was Love Should Have Brought You Home. Actually, You Mean the World to Me was for Anita Baker, too. But that actually, they did that before Love Should Have Brought You Home. And she's like, oh, that's a nice song, but write me another one. Let me hear another one. So that's when Elaine Faith wrote Love Should Have Brought You Home. So, ta-da, here I am.
But are you at all bothered by how particularly American press needs to compare people to others?
No, it doesn't bother me at all. I mean, to be compared to Whitney Houston or Anita Baker, I mean, I'm flattered, of course. But I'd like in the future, if I'm blessed to have a career, people can say, oh, the newest girl sounds like Toni Braxton.
How hard has it been for you to really deal with the tremendous, phenomenal success that you've seen this year? I mean, 2 years ago, you were really, literally, completely unknown to most of America, right. And now you're a household word.
I've been dealing with it well because I'm so grateful and so thankful for God for my talent, and it took so many people to help me get here. And I know that should I think it's all about me, I mean, God can take this from me at any time. And I've only had one album, and so many artists have had successful first albums and you've never heard from them again. So as I say, I'm an exception to that rule, but I'm going to try to do everything I can to ensure a career, but there are no guarantees, you know?
How frightening is that for you?
Very, very, very. Because there are no guarantees, as I said before. And, I mean, there are artists that I've heard, the first album, like, oh my God, they're great. And you're like, okay, they're going to be around forever. And the second album or the third album, it's like, it doesn't happen. And it's not to say they don't have great songs or they're not great vocalists. It's just for whatever reason, it doesn't happen all the time.
2 Grammys, Soul Train Award, American Music Award, over 4 million albums sold, quadruple platinum. When you look at all that, what's your favorite thing that you received this year?
Gosh, they're all equally important. But I was it was so ironic to receive the Soul Train Award because that was something I couldn't watch as a little girl and got in to win, not one but two, an album of the year. That was very special to me. Very special. So I teased my mom, said, Mommy, look, look what I have. She just started laughing. So that's probably the most special award to me because it was part of my struggle to get here. Hate it with the passion. Like, okay, Tony suited. And I go, oh, dang. All right, okay. You know, I don't know why. I just, because it's so redundant for me to do it over and over and over. Okay, all right. You know, that's not my favorite part. My favorite part is performing on stage. That's where I get my high, my Demerol, I'll say. You know, it's like a person who's a bungee jumper. They jump off the building. I call them adrenaline junkies. The same feeling they have, I identify that I have the same feeling when I perform. The crowd, they applaud. And it's a wonderful feeling when someone comes up to you and says, Toni Braxton, I love you. I'm like, oh, thank you. It's a wonderful feeling. It's really wonderful. So that's my high. Yeah.
Ironically, it is Braxton's hatred of studio work that aids to her vocal nuances on record, like her haunting last breath at the end of Breathe Again.
See, I'll do things to be smart. I say, okay, we're keeping it smarty. Like 7 Whole Days. When I first heard 7 Whole Days, a true story, I said, oh, it's an okay song. It's like, you're crazy as a smash, why I order, you know, stuff like that. They thought it was a great song. And I was like, well, I'm not feeling it, guys, but okay, we'll do it. And come to find out, I ended up, of course, loving the song, but it turned out to be a great, great single for me. It really helped my career a lot. And in the studio, like 7 whole nights, I did it to be smart. It's like, okay, we're keeping that too.
We also talked about Toni's want to get into acting. This in part is fueled by her love for old movies and fond memories of situation comedies of her childhood, which led me to this question.
One of the things that is interesting, we talked about acting, and I still haven't figured this one out. You said you used to watch Good Times.
Oh, yes. I love me some J.J. Yes, I did.
You identify with Janet Jackson's character, Penny.
Yes.
But you, as you say, had a crush on Jimmy Walker.
Can you believe
Walker.
I did.
And lesser known, Huggy Bear.
he was so cool, wasn't he? Can you talk to me about that a little bit? My taste has changed a little, but I did love, I loved JJ and Huggy. But JJ was so cool. You know, I really never liked the Dynamite, but I did like the Chill Out. You know, that was so cool. But you know what? A lot of girls had a crush on JJ. They just, like, I'm not going to tell it.
Now the tables have turned, and it is the sexy singer that is gaining the attention of a lot of men, including a movie star who was rumored to have sent flowers as Braxton traveled the country in hopes of gaining her attention. Was this rumor true?
Well, yeah, Wesley did send me flowers on a few occasions, and that's true. He's a very nice guy, very handsome guy, very talented actor, and I was very flattered to receive it from him. Very. Can't lie.
Even though she's been wooed by Wesley Snipes and she's basking in her tremendous popularity, there is a downside to this kind of fame. I asked what was the hardest thing for her to deal with.
That it's called music business, not music arts. And the part that I enjoy most is the performing part, and you don't really get to do that as much. And it's a business. It's operated like a business. It's run like a business. I wasn't expecting that, you know. I read the books, All You Need to Know About the Music Business or whatever, and I think I'm educating myself, but no two contracts are the same and no two careers are run the same. So you have to educate yourself about your contracts, have to get a great manager, have a whole team behind you. It's not just about that microphone, the stage, and the audience, although that's a very important piece of the puzzle. There are other parts of the puzzle that are equally important as well to have a career, and I didn't know that.
Another difficult aspect of fame is the public innuendo. It was said that Braxton hinted she was gay during an appearance on the Arsenio Hall show. I wondered, was it hard for Braxton to deal with this rumor?
It really wasn't too hard. It wasn't hard, I'm gonna be honest. I said, no, I'm not. You know, I didn't get into the details of saying, oh, no, how could you say such a terrible, awful thing about me? Because I know what I am, but I'm not going to sit there and say what's wrong for another person to do, because one of the Ten Commandments is, thou shalt not lie, thou shalt not commit fornication, thou shalt not commit adultery. So at the end, they have to meet with their maker, and gotta say, well, you know, well done or whatever. But, you know, I was disappointed, but I didn't dwell on it too much, because it was, for me, it wasn't true.
Were you at all amazed how quickly a rumor can go across the country?
Yeah, I was. I had heard, you know, people came and said things to me. I was like, okay, how could I say, oh, well, whatever. Well, I've never done panel on Arsenio. I got on Arsenio Hall and I said something about it. But I've performed on Arsenio Hall twice, but I've never done panel. So there you go right there.
Panel meaning getting to the couch, having an opportunity
I've never talked to him, so.
How hard is it for you now to develop friendships? I know a lot of people who were where you are right now, mm-hmm. starting to attain fame and the like, really kind of shy away from people, because you do get people who just latch on because you're Toni Braxton, the singer now, versus just wanting to be Toni Braxton's friends.
Not really that leery of folks. For me, a friend is, when I meet a person, it takes a long time for them to get that title of friend for me. And I have my same friends I had from elementary school and that I met in college. And they're my friends. They're people I meet, and we're cool like that. We may hang out, go out to eat or something like that, go shopping, but I really don't, for my age, being as old as I am, 26, that's old, but sometimes I feel old. To bring anyone else in my life to be a friend, that would take just as long as it has taken for my friends now to become my friends.
In fact, one of Braxton's old friends was the inspiration for one of the songs on her album. Though it is a dubious storyline, it tells of an ex-boyfriend who started dating Braxton's best friend immediately after breaking up with Toni.
This is a true story. It was therapeutic writing it, and, you know, it's kind of my way of getting back at him. I mean, my girl was my girl. She was like my best friend, you know, and the guy, all 10 of them, you know. So my way of getting back at him, sort of.
Have you seen either one of them since your success?
I've seen my girlfriend, and she and I, we're still okay. We'll never be best friends anymore, of course, but she's, you know, I still talk to her on occasion. How you doing? What's been up, you know? But him, oh, God, if I saw him, shoot, I'd probably run over him, probably.
Haven't you wanted to call him, though?
No, I don't know. I couldn't call him, no.
Lastly, we talked about her future. What Toni Braxton hopes to become.
You said that in one interview you wanted to be known as an entertainer, not just a singer.
Yeah.
Is that where you want to end up being? And you noted Barbara Streisand, mm-hmm. Diana Ross, et cetera, et cetera. That's the class you want to be in. Lofty company, but that's what you're shooting for?
Yes. I'm aiming. Definitely.
Why is it important to be more than a singer?
Each his own, but for me, it's just, I love singing, I enjoy singing, but I want to broaden my horizon and explore other parts of the entertainment field other than just singing. So it's a personal goal for me. It's like, okay, plan A was to be a singer. Plan B would have been a school teacher. Went to Bowie State University. And I would have taught elementary education, but I wouldn't have stopped there. I would have wanted to become principal. From there, I'd be a professor at a university and perhaps president of the university. So my mom always taught me, whatever you want in life, aim high.
There's a hoe, and she's a B-I-T-C-H, and she's a money grubber. I